Recorded Books presents The Inferno by Winston Brady, narrated by Shea Taylor. To Rachel, whose constant love, support, and encouragement have made the years of our marriage the brightest and happiest of my life. All that the Father gives me will come to me. And whoever comes to me, I will never cast out. For I have come down from heaven, not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. And this is the will of him who sent me, that I should lose nothing of all that he has given me, but raise it up on the last day. For this is the will of my Father, that everyone who looks on the Son and believes in him should have eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day. John chapter 6, verses 37 through 40. Chapter 1. A Dark Wood. I know I don't deserve forgiveness. Really, I should go to hell. And you would be right in sending me there, because if I know anything about you, God, you are just. So go ahead and send me to a realm of endless torment, since it's way too late for a sinner like me to repent. That moment seemed so long ago. On remembering what I said, I put my hand over the pocket of my black fleece jacket. There, I had stuffed a piece of paper I ripped from the Bible my grandmother gave me years ago. She hoped I would read it, and it might help me stop drinking. And I did read it. Just before I tried to kill myself, but I couldn't make any sense of it. Now I have no idea where I am, and I don't see any trace of the Virginia farm country where I tried to kill myself. Just a cold, dark wood. I'm definitely not in Virginia anymore. I wandered into the woods, stumbling from one patch of moonlight to another. I walked beneath the branches of live oak trees, their bare limbs clawing at the sky like dead men rising from the grave, as a cold wind tore through the branches. I trudged deeper into the woods, the air growing colder and the ground muddier with each step. The trees thinned and gave way to gray reeds and dark rills trickling downward like blood seeping from a wound. I followed the rills to the shores of a still black lake, tendrils of green mist hanging over the waters like a curtain. On the other shore, I saw the opening of a cave, a light flickering inside its mouth and bidding me to come closer. I walked along the strand, avoiding the corpses of birds and fish at my feet. The pale light wavered back and forth inside the cave, trembling like the barest traces of a man from the darkness the thing displaced. I walked to the cave until I recognized what the thing was. The man whose life I had hoped to imitate. The man whose family seemed as cursed as my own. The man whose books I read and reread as my depression and drinking took over. Out of the cave and into the moonlight, bearded and in his hunting gear, stepped the shade of Ernest Hemingway. "Ernest," I stammered out. "Ernest Hemingway, is that really you?" He nodded, but this wasn't an Ernest I ever saw before. It wasn't Hemingway in his prime, days he could spin a fishing trip or a hospital stay into literary gold. Nor was it the Ernest who shot himself in his kitchen wearing a silk robe and slippers. It looked like Hemingway on safari, ready for one last adventure, dressed in a sweaty white-collar hunting shirt and a safari jacket, khaki pants tucked into tall leather boots. He wasn't breathing, and Hemingway's eyes, eyes I remember staring down a kudu or a typewriter, those eyes were as empty and black as the bottom of a well, cheerless and defeated, broken. Only his thick white beard made him look anything like Papa Hemingway again. "Are you Evan?" Evan Esco? The shadow asked me. The boy who tried to kill himself?
I am, I answered. But am I dead? Ernest shook his head no. And you, I asked. What's happened to you, Ernest?
The damned hope that nothing happens when you die, Ernest answered, a look of sorrow passing through him, like wind on the sea. That was my hope, too. But after death comes judgment, and now I am condemned to the forest of the suicides, bound with other shades who took their lives to escape the pain of the world above, until yesterday, when an angel came and released me from my place in hell and bid me to be your guide.
Guide? I asked, backing away. Where are you taking me?
Through hell, Evan, Ernest answered me. God would show you what he would save you from, if you would repent of your sins and mean it truly.
Ernest leaned closer to me. He spoke in a low whisper, like he was afraid someone or something was listening. And he placed a hand on my shoulder like he was talking to one of his sons. He came so close I saw through his shade into the abyss Ernest carried within him, yet stretched far beyond him. He did not breathe, but his words carried the heat of a powerful, unseen furnace. I did not feel cold anymore.
I'll tell you everything I know about what's going on down there, Ernest said, and everyone down there with me. The gluttons and the drunks, the murderers, swindlers, slave drivers and whoremongers, even a few bullfighters. Anyone and everyone who did not get the chance you're getting now.
But I should be damned to hell too, I answered. I want to die so bad, Ernest, and no one should forgive me. Not after the life I've lived. I'm not worth it, and I'll never be one of the good ones.
Maybe it's not about being one of the good ones, Papa Hemingway replied, but you'll have to find that out for yourself.
Ernest turned back into the cave, his shade flickering like a moon-tossed sea. After years of self-destructive behavior, years of drinking, drugs, and depression, I finally self-destructed, and now I didn't have any choice but to follow the shade of my favorite author into the Inferno. Fearful and trembling, I entered a realm as dark as pitch, with only the shade of Ernest Hemingway to light the gathering abyss. Chapter 2. The Guide. At first, the cave was just a tiny breach in the earth's surface. Ernest's shade provided only enough light to see the rock formations cascading out from the walls like fire inside a blast furnace. Ernest easily slipped through the passageway, but I had to squeeze between openings in the rock or crawl on my hands and knees while the roof dropped lower and the way tighter. Stalactites as sharp as dragon's teeth raked across my back, coated with acid that hissed whenever drops of the foul liquid fell to the floor.
Evan Esco, Ernest said to himself. An unusual name, kid. Like Clark Kent, almost. What does it mean?
It's Italian, I answered. And it is kind of like a superhero name. But there's also a Latin word, Evanesco, that literally means I disappear. The irony of it all, since I hoped I would disappear once I killed myself.
Ironic indeed, Hem continued. You know, I've studied death all my life, in the war, the stream, the bull ring, so I want to know. Why did you go and try and kill yourself,
Evan?
Life became so empty. I had been so depressed for so long, and I started drinking and smoking marijuana to make myself feel something, anything, besides the grief after my kid sister died. Evelyn was my only real friend, the only one who could have talked me out of doing what I did, faking a car accident, in hopes I would just die. But she got leukemia, and now she's dead too. And all my efforts to make myself feel better made everything worse. A lot worse.
The drink can be a good thing, if you can control it, Hem answered me in earnest, feeling along the walls until he found another narrow breach in which he disappeared, then called from the void. And if you can't, it controls you.
The more you feed the beast, the more food the beast demands, I answered, repeating a saying I picked up in AA.
The beast now being the name I gave to this part of me that, no matter what, wanted to keep drinking. And then you become a beast, Hem replied. The irony of it all, rejecting God to live however we want, but we end up living like animals.
I felt worse than an animal, though. I felt evil, honestly, Ernest. Evil. Like I was capable of anything given the right circumstances. I was terrified I might really hurt someone when all I really wanted was to be a writer. A writer like you, Ernest. Capable of real greatness. Known. Popular. Admired.
I did a lot of terrible things, kid. Things my writing never made up for. And while I thought it might bring some comfort to be remembered, to meet a fan, it doesn't. Not here. Not like this.
So why'd you do it? Why would you commit suicide after the books you wrote? The greatest writer of the 20th century? How did that not make you happy?
Work made me happy. But it couldn't keep me happy. Not when work brought success, and success brings a different kind of hunger. A yearning. A thirst you can't satisfy. Like you're looking out across the ocean and wondering if you'll ever see land again, growing jealous of birds flying overhead.
Would you tell me how you died then? What happened?
I could write a good book. About life on Earth, now that I'm damned to hell. The forest of the suicides reminds me of the woods at Ketchum where I shot myself. And Ketchum reminded me of summers up in Michigan, fishing for trout and looking at the moon and wondering what I would become in life. But we're almost to the gates of hell.
Ernest led me to the top of a spiral staircase. Winding down into the darkness. He lifted an unlit torch from a sconce and held it inside his chest until the torch caught fire. A hollow gray light tumbled down the stairwell, bright enough for me to see scenes carved into the walls. The way down was adorned with demons. Demons devouring the wings of angels. Demons tempting man with sin. Demons dragging the damned, bound and chained, to hell, never to be seen again. What are these? I asked.
Scenes to terrify the damned. Scenes starting with Lucifer's rebellion, with war erupting in heaven greater than anything we've put together on Earth. More like planets slipping their orbits and going at it like bulls until God defeats Satan and hurls that demon headlong from heaven. That blasted Galano falls for days on end until he lands in the pit just beyond these massive doors. But Satan doesn't stay down for long, and soon he's striking back at God by ruining God's new prized creation, man.
We came to the bottom of the stairs and out into a long hallway. The floor sloped downward,
while the ceiling rose higher and higher into the black expanse above our heads. The light from our torch faded as we pressed on, the flame moving about us like worms nibbling at the darkness. I felt like I hadn't awakened from a dream when the gates of hell emerged from the abyss. Ernest knocked on the massive doors, and silence followed, while we waited for hell's gatekeepers to open and let us in.
"Once we go through this gate, Evan," Hem continued, "there's no turning back. Not unless you get captured by some Galano or until you reach the Lake of Fire at the bottom of hell. Nor will the fiends make it easy on you. They know the more shades you speak with, the more likely it is you'll know what it means to repent, and you'll actually do it. And the demons don't want that happening. So don't wander off."
"I won't," I nodded, noticing letters on the doorway I couldn't quite make sense of. "You can't read in dreams, can you?" So I asked my guide, "Ernest, what is that, written above the gate?"
"The words mean the same wherever they're written, but these are written in English. Abandon all hope, ye who enter here. The irony of it all, I lost all hope long before I came here. But for your sake, I'll try and be happy, and pretend we're fishing in the high hills of Spain, like you're my son, and we're just out for a good time, or that the heat I feel is really the sun shimmering on the Gulf Stream, and we're hooking some big monster from the deep. After all, in a way, that's all we're really doing."
Chapter 3. At Hell. We waited in the darkness until the grind of locks and gears broke the silence. Then the doors opened wide enough for a single solitary wail to escape the portal and dissolve into the darkness. The wail was followed by one scream after another, and then laughter above the screams, a laughter I can only describe as joy perverted, a sickening glee, a cold wind blown through an empty wood. Then Ernest and I stepped over the threshold and into the first realm of the Inferno. Beyond the portal stretched what looked like a massive marketplace, the kind where animals or slaves might be sold at auction, illuminated by the light of a thousand torches. The chamber was filled with the dead, great and small, known and unknown, numberless and hopeless, cast into hell to be processed. The dead poured through a multitude of gates, their souls dragged by demons with long, sharp hooks, as if they were doing no more than breaking a horse. While we walked through the hive of fiends, only one thought occupied my mind: to fly my pain. This is where I would have flown. We walked beneath a vaulted ceiling, not unlike that of a temple or a cathedral. Serpent-like columns supported the roof, and the forum curled left and right like the horns of a crescent moon around the rest of hell, as if we stood on the uppermost level of a stadium encircling the most horrific displays of human misery. The forum ended in a black stone wall separating the vestibule of hell from the rest of hell, punctuated by windows letting in the light of the Inferno. That is, if I could call beams of burning sulfur light. Ernest led me to the end of a long line of fiends and their charges, shades bound hand, foot, and neck, waiting for judgment.
"The rites of condemnation are reserved for fiends selected by the Arch-Galano, Satan," Ernest shouted above the din, scarcely making himself heard. "Demons are not only given higher stations in the abyss malarkey, the caste system of hell, but also privileges they jealously guard from the lesser demons.
Ernest motioned ahead to the judge's tribunal at the far end of the forum. The tribunal was hewn from stone and looked like an altar, behind which the presiding fiend moved about like a shaman or a witch doctor, complete with a headdress of long, jagged spikes running down the length of its spine to form a tail. Lesser fiends tended to a brazier built into the altar, and behind them gaped the eager mouth of hell, outlined in flame. Upon seeing me, the fiends and their charges hastened out of the way and bid me to approach the judge.
Evan Esco,
the judge snarled.
The one who tried to repent. Surely you have come to confess your folly.
God bids this boy to travel the lengths of hell,
Ernest declared,
and see the realm God would save him from. Let us pass.
But the enemy does not save people like you, Evan,
replied the demon.
Do not believe he would, for I know your sins and the enjoyment you reaped from them, and thus how much you really deserve to be here, how much you want to be here. Be assured, the first realm, that of Irachdam, the Sea of Lust, will indeed convince you of your rightful place in hell.
Are you going to let us pass or not?
Ernest snapped.
Don't listen to your guide. He knows neither the enemy nor the plans the enemy hides from everyone but himself. Your guide is here with us, after all. How much can you really trust him? So be warned, Evan Esco, for the damned have wild and fanciful stories to tell, and they think they're right, even though they are in hell.
The judge then bid the lesser demons to let us pass. We moved beside the altar, the brazier smoldering with burnt parchment and blackened flesh, and stepped onto the edge of a cliff. Stairs were carved into the black stone, stairs winding all the way down to what looked like a dock, jutting out into the Sea of Lust, the realm the judge called Irachdam. From atop the staircase, I surveyed the whole of this vast and horrible damscape, adorned with features one might expect to see from the peaks of a mountain up on Earth. Below me, the sea curled around the seemingly limitless expanse of hell. I surveyed the fiery waves until the sea broke upon a distant gray shore, a beach that gave way to a dense swamp cut by rivers of fire and brimstone. Beyond the swamp stretched wide rolling plains, ending at a range of black mountains, barring me from seeing any deeper into hell. The roar of gnashing teeth and the smoke of endless torment rose and settled in the heights of hell, forming dark thunderclouds overhead. But hell had no sky. In its place, hell was sealed with a great black dome, and set in its center, in place of the shining sun, was the reflection of a burning lake, burning from somewhere deeper in the bottomless pit of the Inferno, dark red at its center, with cords of flame convulsing at its edges. The image resembled in appearance a huge and terrible eye, perhaps even the eye of Satan. And though the sun may obliterate anything that dares approach its orbit, I knew deep down, if I was condemned to this burning lake, I would never cease to be. I would keep burning, burning forever, burning like the eye. And there was no turning back. So, with the wild and raging sea below, Ernest and I descended step by step down the cliffs and into the first realm of the Inferno. Chapter 4. The Sea of Lust. We walked down a narrow stairway hanging over the Sea of Lust. The cliffs looked as if they were made of obsidian and slate, with veins of iron coursing through them for added strength. I tried not to look at the eye of Satan burning overhead, but the Sea of Lust was no better, for the eye's matchless flame ignited the waves and made the sea one vast fiery cauldron. If I dared to look over the edge and into the sea, I saw only shades clawing at the surface, like sailors trapped in a sinking ship. Finally, we came to the last step and onto a long, narrow dock. To the dock was moored a ship, reserved, I assumed, for the odd demon that could not fly. The sulfurous air filled my lungs and, mixing with the breath of someone still alive, began to burn. Maybe something like this happens inside the shades, or perhaps this was how temptation works on the soul. For I could feel my inner being begin to burn, my blood boiling and my bones hardening, the way I felt whenever I experienced the temptation to indulge in something forbidden, and I heard the beast speak to me. So what would I find aboard a craft built for the seas of hell? The ship was long and flat, with oars like a galley or a pleasure barge, the kind that might have carried some pharaoh, king, or empress. The ship's prow was carved in the guise of a snake and adorned with jewels for scales, its stern shaped like a tail poised to strike the surface of the water. Hem walked down the jetty without saying a word, just shaking his head, a look of worry passing through him, like the shadow of a great fish in the sea. Then he motioned for me to go up the gangway. I wanted to get away from the unrelenting gaze of the eye, so I hurried up the gangway with him at my heels. The ship was indeed a pleasure craft, for I found a canopy bed covering the ship's entire deck. The bed was carved from smooth ebony pillars and draped with golden and crimson silks. The smell of burning incense wafted out from the canopy bed, scents I thought were foreign to hell, but managed to smother the eternal stench of rotten eggs. I walked to the entrance, like a lamb to the slaughter, and before I could pull the curtains aside, something drew them back for me. Then it grabbed me by the collar. A trio of beautiful women lay waiting there, siren-like, all of whom I recognized way too quickly. Lying across the bed, smiling and giggling, was an array of starlets whose work I knew too well. Aurora Shade, Bella Heat, and Amor Amoria. The shades wore white gowns, gold jewelry, and pearls, each adorned like a Greek goddess fit to be worshipped with the offerings of a sinful boy. They were in hell, but they bore no trace of judgment, as if they were damned the moment their beauty began to turn. I had no idea any of them were dead. A fourth spirit stood at the far end of the canopy bed. This spirit was taller than the others, and while she also wore a white gown, she looked like something more than a shade, yet still less than a fiend. Her green eyes were chased with even greener sulfur-like threads, and her fiery red hair seemingly kissed by hellfire, was braided and slung around her shoulders like a snake. Where was I? Was this really hell? At the moment she smiled at me, our ship unmoored from the dock. The Sea of Lust imperceptibly moved our pleasure barge forward, its oars barely turning the sea as our ship moved with the current. Only then did the spirit in command of this fell craft begin to speak.
"Do make yourself comfortable," she said,
and come closer, for it has been too long since we have seen anyone still alive, and even then we have never seen a boy as cute as you. Is this really hell? I asked, entranced. Who are you?
I have had so many names, she said, smiling, stretching toward me, for I have long been worshipped by the mortal beings I serve, whose hearts I fill with pleasure. But you may call me Lilith, our father herein, my lord and prince, Lucifer, gave me not only my beloved name, but also my noble task, for it is I who fill the flowers with the fragrance that attracts the bees, the birds, the sweet songs they sing out above the trees, and to the lovers among mankind, I give to them whatever their hearts desire. Indeed, an ounce of happiness from my embrace is often the only recompense for mankind's toil upon the earth. And now, though I am confined to this sea of fire and brimstone, I still watch over and tend to those shades who give themselves to lovers and to love.
Love? Condemned? For love? I asked, and looked at him. I don't understand. How can anyone be damned for love?
Do we look damned?
Lilith asked and smiled, cupping her hand behind a shade.
Do we not look free? Free and happy to enjoy the heights of love without the rules God tries in vain to set upon human happiness. Love has no bounds, and even if love had such limits, God could not set them. Why, can anyone bind the stars that guide youthful hearts in love, or stop the roses in mid-bloom, or bid the birds to cease their serenading once they wake from a night of bliss? Of course not, my sweet, sweet boy. For when animals feel such a desire, they act upon it without fear or scruple. You should do the same whenever desire alights upon you. Just like our ship glides upon this wondrous current without thought, care, or design. Truly, if you are to love anyone, you must break the bounds God jealously imposes upon human happiness and go beyond the silly rules God claims are there to protect love.
I heard something below, clawing at our hull. Behind the shades, I could see the reflection of the lake of fire churning in the vault over hell while the reek of brimstone seeped across the deck. I tried to say something, but Aurora Shade, black-haired and giggling, brought a finger to my lips. Then, with a voice still so sweet, Aurora's spirit began to speak.
You cute, cute boy,
Aurora cooed.
We are so happy you came here and found us. But why have you come?
Bella Heat whispered next.
What's your name, sailor?
My name is Evan, I responded, stunned.
And why are you here, Evan?
I don't know, I stuttered. I tried to kill myself last night, and I...
Oh, we can help you with that,
Bella answered me, and put a finger to my lips.
You shouldn't feel sad now. And you need not feel sad ever again, now that you're here. Here with us.
Are you a fan of our work?
Asked Amor.
Surely you are, I can always tell when I've met a fan.
I do know you, I answered sheepishly, and I have seen your movies. I'm ashamed to it.
Ashamed? Why?
Aurora asked.
We made them for you, silly boy, you and all our fans. And surely our fans, they still remember us.
I don't know if they remember you, I answered with some pity, or if they even know you're gone. I didn't know.
You mean you don't know how we died?
Bella asked despondently, as if she didn't know either.
Oh, don't mind her,
Aurora cooed, ignoring Bella.
Come closer, sweet boy. It's been so long since any of us have seen anyone still alive. We barely know what to do with ourselves. Perhaps you should tell us what to do,
Amor added, pulling me closer.
For we're so desperate for your help since you, and only you, can help us escape from here. Oh yes, help us,
Bella pleaded, regaining her fallen self.
For only a mortal boy, a living mortal boy, can help us escape. Oh, please, won't you help us? You're our only hope,
Amor echoed.
Please, help us.
How can I help you? I asked, my desire beginning to catch fire. How can I escape?
Give yourself to us.
Amor responded sultrily.
One real moment with us, Evan, could set us free. Free from hell forever. And free you too, just like we freed you from your cares and troubles for a time up on Earth. Won't you help us, Evan?
Aurora pleaded.
Like we helped you. Oh, please, Evan, we need you.
But if you knew about this place, I stammered, trembling, would you have tried to escape your troubles any differently? Would you have lived any differently if you knew about what happens when you die?
Hush, sweet boy, answered Amor Amoria,
putting a finger to my lips, pouting, leaning closer.
We're not bad girls. In fact, God made us this way. And if God never wanted us to live the lives we did, then why would God give us so many fans?
For years, I acted upon my lust whenever I wanted it, however I could get it. Why should now be any different? But that freedom, the power to give into whatever desire chances upon a person, with whatever person the object of someone's lust happens to be, I knew somewhere this was wrong, but I only barely cared. The dilemma turning over in my soul, along with fire and brimstone. Should I give up whatever hope of heaven I could have if I repented, so as to enjoy, right now, the pleasures my sinner-most self deeply desired, the shades I saw sprawled before me?
What's wrong, sailor?
Bella asked.
Are we not enough for you?
He's scared, Amor cooed.
Scared to embrace the one happy lot still left to man. Scared, because then he'd be free. Oh, Evan, like Adam and Eve's time in the Garden of Eden,
Bella cooed.
You must reject God whenever he dares to restrain your freedom. This poor, sweet boy, he just needs some fun and cheer,
Amor whispered.
Won't you take my hand and stay with us in here?
The objects of my sad, lonely lust grabbed a hold of me, holding me tighter, my consciousness streaming on ahead of me while I tried to resist the temptation with whatever strength I had left. For if I yielded, I would be damned to hell forever, wouldn't I? But what was one little sin? Couldn't I give in, just a little, and help these poor shades, sweet as they are, misunderstood as they were in life? Couldn't I accept their embrace and go back on my journey? No, I can't. I can't keep on sinning and expect to live, even if I'm desperate for any sort of release from hell and from the habits now so deeply ingrained in me. And that's why I killed myself, since I couldn't escape what I became. Still, my mind raced to find some source of help, any help at all, until my train of thought settled on the page I ripped out from the Bible last night in the final moments before I killed myself. So, maybe if I just touched that crumpled piece of paper, I might really be free. I reached for my pocket and the page, and as soon as my fingers grazed its ink, I passed out, falling upon the deck as though I'd died, while more shades escaped the sea and flew furiously by. Chapter 5. The Shores of Gluttony. I thought I might have been dreaming again, but then I opened my eyes, and the image of the burning lake hurled me back to my new reality. The waves of the sea of lust were breaking upon me, soaking me in fire and brimstone, and I realized I was thrown onto the beach at the shoreline of hell. I jumped up and looked around, and saw a shade, the largest shade I've seen so far in hell, eating what looked like tar. I tried not to move, afraid the shade might consume me too, but that shade was too consumed with its food to notice me. That shade was one of a multitude of the dead swarming the beach, all of whom were devouring the pitch-like sand and mingling their food with their tears. I didn't move until Hemingway grabbed me and pulled me up from the sands and shades.
"You did all right on that ship, kid," Hemingway said, pulling tar off my shoulder. "I wouldn't have lasted that long, especially if we were on the Pilar and I had them to myself."
"Did you know what was going to happen?" I asked him, shaking. What would have happened if I didn't pass out? Or if I yielded to my fantasy and my lust, would I have been damned? And why did I pass out when my hands simply touched the piece of paper I ripped out from the Bible?
"I was told the route to take, and the shades you'd have to speak with," Hem answered. "But I was not told of every trial you would have along the way, though I had my suspicions. Heading into that boat, it'd be a trap. The demons want to devour you whole, after all, just like a Galano, and they won't make your journey easy on you. In that way, we're more like fish in the Gulf Stream, the demons trying to hook us."
"What happened to those shades?" I asked. "Do you know?"
"Why they were damned?" Hem answered me in earnest. "I don't know. But if they were anything like the women in my books, women I subjected to a fate that didn't care how pretty they were, they had sad, lonely lives, families that split apart, fathers who left, their looks the only thing to get them through a world otherwise indifferent to them."
I watched their scenes without ever wondering who they were. I hung my head in shame. Could they have been saved, Ernest, if they repented?
"I think you'll find out, if you haven't already, why most people don't want to be saved."
"Where are we now, then?" I asked my guide.
"The shores of Gluttony," Hem responded. "A realm filled with gluttons. The fiends call them binge wraiths. Shades who gave their lives to eating and to drinking, but their real sin was not so much in what they consumed, but in what they turned to instead of God: food, booze, drugs, to comfort them, feed them, strengthen them, until there was nothing left in them except an empty shell, a wraith, like an abandoned tent set up by a hiker lost in the woods.
This is where I belong, Ernest. I had so much potential, Ernest, and I wasted it, all of it. I grew up with too much money and freedom, and I spent it all on alcohol and drugs, and all because I hated myself so much, hating myself and hating God for making me the way I am. Hem motioned for me to follow him through the gluttons. As we moved, the binge wraiths would rise en masse and bear down upon us like a tidal wave, pulling me down with them. I've lived my whole life looking for joy at the bottom of an empty bottle. And while the pleasure I might find in binge drinking or overeating felt good for a while, my pursuits always left me emptier than before. The bites and drafts draining my soul of the strength I needed to face my problems. That pattern continued until I killed myself. I could barely keep up with Ernest. The lake of fire burning overhead made the black, tarry sands unimaginably hot. So we made our way through the realm as quickly as we could. Occasionally, I stepped on the backs of the gluttons, like I was crossing a wide and ravenous river, one rock at a time, always hurrying on to the next shade. Then Ernest led me to one massive glutton, perched upon a mass of wraiths, bearded and dressed, despite the heat, in a black woolen suit. He took no notice of us at first. In spite of his place in hell, the shade was singing with whatever remained of his lungs. In my speech I said my motto, an old one tried and true, do unto others as you wish they do to you. Thus we live to feed the masses, the great joy of our hall, out of lack of faith for God to feed anyone at all. Oh, I swear I'd keep my word, my oath I made by St. Paul, but things did take a horrid turn. I'm here, aren't I? Since I joined Tammany Hall, still we live to feed the masses, the great joy of our hall. Out of lack of faith for God, to feed anyone at all. Finally, the shade saw me, stopped singing, and bellowed,
Why, hello there, and who might you be?
My name is Evan, sir, I answered meekly. And who are you?
Boss is fine,
the shade answered, raising his hands in the air.
A boss I still am after all, if only of what I see from my noble perch. And boss I once was, indeed, grand sachem of the noble society of Saint Tammany. Those were the days, and that's all you need to know. Now, what brings you to these parts?
I killed myself last night, but God, for reasons I don't entirely understand, is letting me see the hell I would have sent myself.
And what do you think of our accommodations?
The shade, whoever he was, replied.
I do miss my evenings at Delmonico's, but this tar has quite a kick to it, doesn't it?
Laughing and kicking the shades beneath him. This place is terrifying, I said, feeling the eye bearing down on me. But why, if you were a saint, why are you here in hell?
Ah, a saint?
The shade guffawed and reeled backwards.
He thinks me a saint. Indeed, in many ways I proved a saint for the charity and the alms I gave the poor. But of course I did a lot of other things, too.
So why are you here, then? I asked him again, staring in horror at his throne of shades and remembering how much I deserved to be here.
Now I've wondered that myself, but I suppose my gluttony drove on all the rest of my sins. So base and powerful as that one sin is. And as the rivers surround Manhattan, so I stood at the confluence of three powerful currents, so extolled in my refrain, the feeding of the masses, the joys of the hall in feeding them, and the diminishing faith that God would feed anyone at all. Let me tell you a story, my lad, the shade began, of a poor oyster, a poor, poor oyster, tossed about by the waves of fortune into New York Harbor. He heard everywhere he was equal to the other animals in town, even if clad in a shell and lacking legs and all. And yet this poor oyster was oyster-sized by all his peers. The established animals wanted nothing to do with him, nor with any of the untold masses of freshly arrived oysters in the city. And what is this poor creature to do? That oyster wandered about town looking for food, crying for help, shedding briny tears inside that cold, tiny shell of his. No one heard him. No one helped him. No one cared for him. Until the day that oyster chanced upon a walrus who, being a walrus, was also shunned by all the creatures of New York. Mind you, a walrus is built for the sea, built to withstand the cold, cruel Arctic currents. And thus, this walrus built up the means of taking care of cold little animals, lost and on their own, this oyster being one of them. And what did our friend the walrus do? Why, he did all he could to help that little fellow, finding him a job, housing, even so little a boon as a lump of coal to warm that shell of his through the winter. And what happened next? I asked. Did they live happily ever after? Well, the walrus certainly did, the shade replied, whose massive girth and bushy mustache made him look very much like a walrus himself. For a time, that is. What does that story mean? That, I suppose, you'll have to figure out for yourself, the shade guffawed again. Once you figure that out, you'll have figured out everything else. The shade plunged his hand into the mound of shades, pulled out a mass of sticky tar, and stuffed it in his mouth. Then, in between bites, the shade proclaimed, I wish you the best of luck upon your journey. Huzzah, and good day to you both. Ernest motioned for me to follow him, and, once we were far enough away from the boss, Ernest turned to me and said, I recognize.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.